Bad Taste is a 1987 homemade science fiction comedy and Peter Jackson's first feature film. This low-budget splatterfest follows a group of government agents from a top-secret organization called
the Astro Investigation and Defense Service,
or AIDS.
Wish we'd change that name.
Derek, Frank, Ozzy, and Barry investigate the mysterious disappearance of the population of the town of Kaihoro. They find that the town has been overrun by man-eating space aliens disguised in blue shirts. Any first film in a director's career is very important to consider and analyze, as every project that Peter Jackson has made since has been thanks to and built upon this formidable entry in the world of professional filmmaking. Its cult status as a messily indulgent gore fest speaks highly to the then 26-year-old's capabilities and his early influences while growing up. Peter grew up in 1960s and 1970s New Zealand, which was an isolated media landscape with only one TV channel, and where British and Hollywood exports largely dominated the marketplace. The campy yet creative Gary Anderson's Thunderbirds and Adam West's Batman, the outrageously funny Monty Python's Flying Circus, the iconic Hammer horror features, and the innovative Ray Harryhausen Greek epics have all been cited as some of Peter Jackson's greatest influences growing up. He was also an avid fan of magazines such as Fangoria, Famous Monsters of Filmland, and Gorezone, which cultivated in him a finer grasp of the exploitative nature of cinema found in B-movies. Jackson was also obsessed with the physicality of the kinetic comedy of silent films such as Buster Keaton and Charlie Chaplin, a style that he would be replicating in the 1995 TV movie Forgotten Silver, and apply to many of his physical gags throughout his films. One could argue that his biggest influence in those years was Willis O'Brien's special effects work on the 1933 King Kong. A religious experience for the young boy, Jackson describes it as,
"For me, that was the film that really made me want to become a filmmaker, because it was so magical and such an escapist trip that I wanted to be the guy that actually sort of could do that and make these things happen and start from nothing, but, you know, create adventures that had all this stuff on them."
This wide-eyed attitude towards the magic of cinema armed a young Peter Jackson with a do-it-yourself philosophy. And when he received a Super 8mm movie camera one Christmas before his 9th birthday, he immediately began toying with the frame. Jackson states in the same interview as earlier that
The first one was a World War II movie with me in a trench. I was able to get together a little costume collection, which was useful. Well, I tried to remake King Kong, and I shot a little bit of that, and I still have the puppets. And I did a big Waterloo battle with my plastic soldiers, sort of stop motion animation, so they're all just marching along and cotton wool explosions. I shot a James Bond film, and I do these fight scenes with a couple of my friends, and they were really, you know, quite well choreographed fights, but it was all to do with editing, and that was where I learned how to chop this film up with scissors and glue it back together again with little bits of paste. And
these first experiments help us to better understand the nature of this highly kinetic filmmaker, who immediately felt comfortable in blending special effects with live action. We see this most clearly in his 1976 entry to a film competition on a local children's program called Spot On. Called The Valley, it is an 18-minute short with two complicated stop-motion sequences in which a young 12-year-old Jackson fights a giant cyclops. It is an homage to the fusion of live action and claymation, most often called dynamation, that Harryhausen mastered in The Seventh Voyage of Sinbad and Jason and the Argonauts. There was, however, way more violence than the judges either expected or wanted, says his childhood friend and Bad Taste crew member Ken Hammond. This anecdote serves as an example of Jackson's early ambition. His 11 mostly unfinished projects before Bad Taste were peppered with ingenious special effects. Among the makeup, daring sequences, and the homemade prop guns and models, one of his favorite tricks was optically burning white flashes in the place of gunshots, something he would repeat on Bad Taste. The unfinished 1981 short, The Curse of the Gravewalker, is an homage to Hammer horror features and was financed by Jackson's first job as a photo engraver at the local Wellington Evening Post newspaper. It features his first use of specially acquired cinemascope lenses. But it was Jackson's 1983 purchase of a 16mm Bolex camera which spurned him towards the making of a 10-minute short entitled The Roast of the Day. Originally planned as a one-month shoot, as he has since stated, by accident rather than design, this little number mutated into Bad Taste. The story of how Bad Taste became the beloved cult movie it is today and launched Jackson into a successful career can be summarized in three key sections. Get ready, strap in your socks and your boots, because we're in for a ride. Every Sunday, after having spent the week tinkering with props and saving money to buy rolls of film, Jackson and his mates would convene at spots along Pukaria Bay and shoot what would become Bad Taste. Jackson's DIY workshop was the birthplace of not only most of the film's outlandish props and special effects, but he also produced a camera crane, a Steadicam, and dolly tracks. This not only saved money, but it greatly increased the quality of the footage. At first, the short story was fairly contained, centered on Craig Smith's character, Giles, a food inspector who falls victim to a gang of cannibals. But the project drastically evolved in 1984 and 1985. A year after shooting began, Jackson produced a 75-minute rough cut of the film at the National Film Unit. Realizing that he was sitting on a possible feature-length project and encouraged by the success of other 16mm semi-amateur splatter films such as Sam Raimi's Evil Dead, he began to mutate the story line into more and more ambitious sequences. Ken Hammond states that since the film was never scripted, there was a tendency to add details and for simple sequences to end up much more elaborate than planned. This directorial attitude would have been impossible for more professional and therefore less flexible film shoots. Yet it proved to be a strength of the film, which organically grew through years of alterations. After the 1985 departure of key cast members Craig Smith and Terry Porter for personal reasons, one had become an ardent Christian and the other had moved to Australia for love, Jackson adapted and minimized their role in the overall story. As Craig Smith said in an interview, all that shaped the story. It was at that point that Jackson introduced the idea of capitalist aliens packaging humans for an intergalactic fast food chain.
Bastards.
As Robert McKee states in Story, as you rework a story's substance, the telling reshapes itself. Its intellectual and emotional spirit evolves. Perhaps Jackson had no choice but to reshape or clean up the story through constant obstacles during the shoot. Yet, it does result in an oddly focused collage of splatter and Kiwi quips.
Don't you forget, Oz, we're only authorized to use violence when it is a threat to the planet Earth.
And the moon.
Yeah, and the moon.
This ability to improvise with new on-set circumstances and to absorb information from films, replicating them in his own works, is something that we see throughout Jackson's career. For example, here is a scene from Bad Taste involving two characters played respectively by Peter Jackson and Peter Jackson. The sequence was composed as a shot reverse shot of the two characters fighting, but filmed a year apart. Yet, such is Peter's understanding of film grammar that the illusion is completely successful. We can see Jackson applying this method remarkably well in the Stairs of Serif Ungol sequence in The Lord of the Rings, Return of the King, where Gollum has manipulated Frodo into sending Sam back home. This emotionally wrenching scene is filmed on both characters a year apart, and yet, as in the Derek and Robert Clifton battle in Bad Taste, the illusion works flawlessly because Jackson demonstrates an acute ability to capture the same emotional and physical space in a scene consistently. This skill has proven useful in developing his directing style, which is said to be reliant on constant script revisions, improvisations on set, and reshoots well into post-production to further fine-tune his narratives.
I've seen enough of Peter's work to know that A, he's out there, and B, he usually makes the out there stuff work.
Those of you who have seen Jackson's bigger budget extravaganzas may notice just how well the action flows together, especially when it's incorporating so many elements that can go wrong, such as complicated set pieces, hundreds of extras, and fusions of CGI and practical special effects, all in the same sequence and rolled up in a lovely goo of cinema. In terms of the special effects on Bad Taste, Jackson stated in an interview that Tom Savini's Grand Illusions book was my main reference source throughout. Cameron Chittick's help was also invaluable during the last year of production, which was when he was brought on to fine-tune the alien prosthetics. Tom Savini is one of the finest makeup artists in cinematic history. He's the wizard overlord of egregious splatter and practical ingenuity. So it's not surprising that Jackson lifted many techniques from these Bibles for special effects artists. Savini's books, Bizarro and Grand Illusions, reflect many of the same practices that Jackson applied to Bad Taste. For instance, the methods that Jackson employed in producing the prototypes of the alien masks is a process that he would keep coming back to for his later projects, and he would expand it digitally with Richard Taylor and Weta Digital. First, a plasticine mold would be sculpted to achieve the best, and in this case, worst proportions. Then, a plaster of Paris cast had to be set one section at a time for an overall 5 to 6 sections for the best homogenization. Then, later covered in foam latex to create the skin-tight mask, and finally baked in his mother's oven.
The size of this head was determined by the size of the oven, and I managed to get it so that it could just squeeze in with about 1/2 inch to spare, which is why he's got quite a flat top on his head.
It was later in the project that Cameron Chittick, a local polytechnic student who met Jackson in 1985, described helping him make the puppet versions of the alien prototypes, which end up in the final cut of the film. Peter wanted me to puppeteer them, so I altered them to work that way, and making fiberglass versions of the molds, attaching wires around the mouth to give the appearance of speech. Hence, we now have the iconic Lord Crumb, the main alien antagonist and pièce de résistance of the film's splatter fun. This is important, because in every B-movie, especially splatter films, there needs to be a visual payoff. Be it over-the-top silly or ingenious or disgusting or all of them at the same time, for the audience to reach an often comedic catharsis. After a few years of scaring a bunch of sheep with his guns and aliens, the local press started to take an interest in Jackson's weird venture. It was at that time as well that he was working on a local television show called Wurzel Gummidge Down Under. This introduced Jackson to industry professionals in New Zealand who would greatly give shape to his career, such as Fran Walsh, Dan Mulheron, Stephen Sinclair, George Port, Cameron Chittick, Richard and Tanya Taylor, and Costa Botes. New Zealand was a minuscule cottage industry which relied heavily on government subsidies to produce a handful of critically successful arthouse movies, such as Jeff Murphy's 1980 domestic hit Goodbye Pork Pie. They, however, failed to capture the attention of the international box office. However, I believe that this smaller scale gave further opportunities for smaller filmmakers to collaborate with more successful artists on projects, creating a vibrant and proud cinephile culture. Cinema is not only about creative prowess, it's also a business. There came a point where Jackson simply couldn't continue on his own. The first 3 years of production were entirely self-funded. He estimated to have spent 8,000 New Zealand dollars over that period, with Ken Hammond investing $500. Much of the movie was produced on a hand-to-mouth budgeting basis, where Jackson funneled his personal savings into buying film and processing it. He circumnavigated usual production costs by producing his own in-house special effects and building his own film equipment, resulting in a great production value. However, money was running dry. His $12,000 a year salary was simply not supporting the growing scale of the project. In 1985, encouraged by his peers, Jackson began to petition the New Zealand Film Commission for an additional $7,000. As Ken Hammond explained, the New Zealand Film Commission is a government agency that runs scared of public controversy. Unfortunately, bad taste was pretty controversial. The unfinished product failed to impress or attract the committee. However, the commission's chief executive, Jim Booth, was immediately enthusiastic about the young filmmaker and decided to support Jackson through the commission's script development fund. He also introduced Jackson to editor Jamie Selkirk and producer Tony Hiles, which ensured that Bad Taste made it out of Pukaria Bay. As Costa Botes puts it, "When I first met Peter, he had no relationships with any of these companies or places. He had been working totally alone, or with just Ken Hammond helping him. After Jim Booth took an interest and paired him up with Tony Hiles, a support network quickly coalesced. Tony gave Peter organizational and moral support. Jamie Selkirk offered a base of operations and his invaluable skills as an editor." As Jamie Selkirk put it when I interviewed him,
It was pretty unfinished. It was a bit rough around the edges. So we went back to Jim Booth and said, this guy looks like he's got a bit of talent, it might be worthwhile throwing a bit of money at this movie to get it completed, to see how it goes.
The eventual cost of Bad Taste ended up hovering around $200,000. Jim Booth's under-the-table script development fund, estimated to total around $30,000 to $50,000, was an initial financial boost that enabled Jackson to quit his job in 1986 and work full-time on the project. It was at that time that he completed the most spectacular sequences of the film, including constructing two models of Gearhouse, the alien HQ and main location for action scenes, which had been lent on the weekends to Jackson by the owners, who happened to be family friends. There was also enough money for Derek's brain surgery effects, and more importantly, the cathartic gore fest that is the death of Lord Crumb, which I'll just let the whole thing play out because it's honestly one of my favorite things ever put on film. Warning, it's pretty graphic.
Suck my spinning steel, shithead!
Seriously though, go watch this film if you haven't. It's on YouTube, it's free. Bad Taste was primarily edited in Jamie Selkirk's Mr. Chopper editing rooms in Courtney Place, Wellington, which was a hive of activity for guerrilla Kiwi filmmakers. Other services used in Bad Taste's post-production was equipment hire company Film Facilities, run by Murray Milne, who would go on to be a cinematographer for Jackson on Meet the Feebles and Braindead. Because Jackson had no field recording equipment, Bad Taste was filmed without sound and dubbed chopped in post, resulting in even more freedom for him to edit together the patchwork of loose storylines into a feature-length narrative. Most of the eventual budget of Bad Taste was allocated to the post-production. Jackson states in 1988 that, although the whole thing was made cheaply, we wanted to make the music, the sound effects, quite good. Jamie Selkirk mentions this ragtag yet effective editing process as such.
We had no specific sound engineers or sound designers. It was really just the film editor did all the sound as well. So you'd cut the film and then you'd lay the music, you'd do all the effects. Every gunshot you'd cut in and do all the stuff with the Foley and do all the post-syncing was all done by the editor really.
All of this really highlights that as ingenious as Jackson was, he needed industry professionals to complete Bad Taste and get it to a format ready for wider consumption. Costa Botes states that,
Jim, I wish there were more like him. Jim saw what I saw when he watched Peter's edit. He saw an extraordinary filmmaker. You know, he had a sense of humour and he had the ability to actually see behind the sort of egregious splatter that this guy was actually a very, very clever filmmaker.
After this important first but not last collaboration, Bad Taste was finally ready for release. Although yet again, Jackson and Booth had to fight to convince the New Zealand Film Commission to put in another $40,000 to blow up the film from 16mm to 35mm print for an international distribution. Originally, the commission only wanted to release it on domestic home video. And if that was the case, we might never have heard of Peter Jackson. And so, after years of fragmented shoots, jostling for scraps, and establishing a network in Wellington, Jackson screened Bad Taste internationally in over a dozen countries. Its success allowed Jackson to flourish in the industry, and the film would be a stamp on the director's career as one at the forefront of New Zealand cinema. The film made an impression at the 1988 Cannes Film Festival, at the 1988 Paris Horror Film Festival, and in Italy at the Fanta Festival. A Variety review of the time states that what the film certainly does is to serve notice that Jackson's next picture will be one to look out for. This movie transported international audiences with its distinct and unfamiliar sense of locale, Kiwi humour, and outrageous gore. It's important to note how humour is really what gives life to the story and what gave it its cult movie appeal. The effects would mean nothing without context. The gags are crude and generally tend to take the piss, embracing its amateur roots. For example, take Derek's van adorned with a cardboard cutout of the Beatles as it cuts an alien in half. Or the local town named Kaihoro, which is a Maori term for eat well. Duncan Petrie and Duncan Stewart define Kiwi humour as having a regional cultural dimension, which is apparent depending on which region of New Zealand the film was made. This is really evident when critic Jeremy Clarke described Bad Taste as more than a New Zealand film, more than a regional film. It's a Pukaria Bay film. Bad Taste sparked an interest from French, Italian, Japanese, and Korean investors for distribution rights and future investments. Jackson's next film, Meet the Feebles, was almost entirely funded by Japanese investors. More on that in my next video. There was also an extremely positive domestic response. The crew recalls one of the finest moments as when Bad Taste was screened to a roaring crowd at the Wellington Embassy Theatre. It also convinced the New Zealand Film Commission to continue supporting Jackson with his future projects. However, it will not be the last of the negative run-ins that Jackson had with this organisation. Richard Taylor has said in a 1989 Gore Zone interview that, in New Zealand, the thought that you could follow a career as a director was preposterous. But the response to Bad Taste was so powerful that it convinced Jackson that this was his calling.
We've got to